Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us as we come together to worship God and to hear his message of how we can live for him. Whether you're joining us on Sunday morning or catching up later in the week, we're really glad that you're here. One way that we can be built up as a faith community is to hear about how God has been working in our lives. At the end of this service, we're going to listen to a song called The Blessing, and in that time, we invite you to leave comments on YouTube or Facebook telling us about how God has been blessing you. Although I'm recording this a few days ahead of time, there'll be some of the team online and they would love to read and share your comments and celebrate with you how God has been blessing you. Tony Burbeck is going to be bringing the message to us this morning based on the next passage of the book of Thessalonians. And later in the service, we'll have a block of prayer where we can ask for forgiveness, where we can thank God, and where we can bring our concerns and our worries to him.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? And so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. To order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Events in the news over the last few days and weeks have left many people feeling afraid and heartbroken. But let's not forget, we have a gospel of peace. Let's choose unity and justice and kindness and love and forgiveness. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we sing words of praise to you this morning, remind us to use words to build each other up and not tear each other down. As we listen to the words from the Bible and the message that Tony's going to bring, let us not just hear the words and forget, but really take to heart what it teaches us. And as we pray for forgiveness, and as we pray for reconciliation, and as we pray for the desperate situations in our world, remind us, Lord, that through you, all things are possible. And now our special prayer, the collect for this Sunday. God of truth, help us to keep your law of love, to walk in ways of wisdom, that we may find true life through Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen.
Our reading this morning is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men, who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words.
Let's begin with a prayer. Lord, as we ponder these words of Paul to those new Christians, open our minds and hearts to hear your words of encouragement and hope, and to be reassured that we are not left behind, but that you are with us at times of joy and sadness, of hope and despair, life and death. We ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. All of you except the youngest will have been to a funeral, and perhaps even they will have experienced grief and sadness when someone that they've loved and has been near to them has died. Now the older ones among us know grief and sadness in death only too well, because it's become more frequent as family members and friends have died. Death is part of our human experience. And we've heard in recent weeks of the additional sadness of people dying without family being able to be there, or when the family has been unable to have a funeral in the normal sense, a time to remember and to say a proper goodbye. So there's been no tribute, no words of hope, or prayers, or music. The stories, the tears, the hugs, and the memories that all help to soften the sharp edges of grief. And on top of all that, there are, of course, the normal uncertainties that people feel at times of death and bereavement. Like, well, where are they now? In last week's passage from Paul's letter to those new Christians in Thessalonica, we heard how Timothy was reporting back to Paul about how those who he cares so deeply for were getting on with their new faith. We heard last week how they were told to persevere in love and holiness to each other and to others outside their Christian community, and to be an example to those who weren't Christians, keeping well clear of the various sorts of immoral behaviour that were part and parcel of that culture at that time. Now, another thing that Timothy is reporting on, something he's learned when he's gone back to those Christians there, is that people have died. And like us, there is grief. Now, to understand exactly what Paul's getting at in this context, you have to know something about how they saw the possible early return of Jesus. They hoped for that and they thought it was going to be fairly soon. And it's quite clear from this reading that we've heard that they didn't know what to make of it in terms of whether those who've died will miss out and not share the joy and excitement of Jesus' return. So in verse 13 we have Paul responding by saying, "Don't grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope." Now, the Greeks, I understand, the Gentiles, didn't believe in any life after death, and even part of the Jewish tradition was pretty bleak and miserable. Think of the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes, as bleak and miserable as it comes. It begins in the first couple of verses with these words, "Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless." And so it goes on in that vein, though curiously in chapter 3, part of it is sometimes read at funerals today. And you possibly recall the passage. It begins, "There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die," and so on. Now Paul writes that that's not how it is for those of us who believe in the love and power of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's as true for us today as it was for those who'd come new to the faith in Thessalonica. And this passage today is about hope based on the new life that we're promised by Jesus' resurrection and his unity and closeness to the Father. So this message for those new Christians is that neither they nor those for whom they grieve will be forgotten or excluded. It's about hope and encouragement. And hope and encouragement are what people like me, the clergy, and other people try to give in helping people to face grief, sadness, and uncertainty when people die. As I've said, Christians at that time were hoping for and expecting Jesus to return soon. Now, whatever they made of that rather strange apocalyptic scenario, which is in verses 16 to 18, whatever they made of that in a literal sense, it's pretty certain that we struggle with it now. Can we really believe it in that literal sense? Well, it's been suggested that it was partly a challenge to how people saw the power and the priorities of Imperial Rome. A delegate, perhaps a senior member of the hierarchy in the Roman Empire, or even the emperor himself, would arrive somewhere in the empire with pageantry and fanfare. And this may be saying something like, well, when Jesus returns, that's the sort of welcome that he will merit. It'll be more worthwhile and just as spectacular as someone arriving in pomp from Rome. And maybe it's a reminder too that the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, the peace that the empires brought, was in fact based on force and might. And that's been true, I guess, for every empire through the ages. And that's in contrast to the love and compassion which bring real peace and security. Now, we don't know what the reality of a new resurrection life will be. There are far too many unknowns. But we are called to have faith in God. We should look for signs that God has not forsaken us. And there are signs. Signs that we're not, as it were, left behind. And to think about where we would put our hope and trust. And that's just as important a question today as maybe it was then. Do we place more and more confidence in governmental powers, in the powers that be, to hope that they will create situations where the proper priorities in life are lived out? I don't think it's very likely in today's circumstances. Or do we look for the fundamental truths of our faith that can create peace, security, love, and hope? So where do we put our faith? I read an article quite recently about the novelist Graham Greene, and he had a friend who was a Spanish priest. And Greene describes this friend as not being terribly pious, but being a man of very deep faith. And this friend apparently said, "I don't believe in God, I touch him." And that brought me up sharp because it really rang some bells with me. Now, I know this won't be true for everyone, but it made me realise that ever since childhood, I'd never thought much about whether I believed in God. I had faith that he was always there. There at the decision points, and there were loads of them over the years. There at the times of joy and inevitably the times of sadness. I felt that he was there. I felt the presence. Faith rather than a querying of belief. In faith, we can look for signs in everyday things that tell us God's love and presence are real. Now, I think for some people, self-isolation or partly self-isolation may have helped us to think about and reflect on the things that really matter and what's most important. And one of the things that people have apparently come to realise recently is that a sense of worth is at the centre, at the heart of most things. Just as we have worth and are valued by God. It's about kindness, compassion, generosity, and the ability to give and receive love. and to forgive and be forgiven. Aren't those the sorts of things that God is about? It's about service to others, and it's about switching our focus from ourselves to others. And I think those are among the signs of God present and at work with his people, and in his people, and through his people. I very recently received an email from a friend, which included this, and I'd like to share it with you. And if the friend is watching, and possibly he is, thank you. But these are the words. Christ has no body but yours, no hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes with which he looks with compassion on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands with which he blesses all the world. Yours are the hands, yours are the feet, yours are the eyes. You are his body. Christ has no body now on earth but yours. I read a short review of a book. The book is called Just Passing Through. And it's about our relationship with life and death. It's about confronting any fear of dying and accepting our physical mortality. And can I just get this in, please? Please, let's say die and not pass away. But in this book, it is partly about the contrast to what's the point of doing anything if it's all for naught in the end, which leaves us inward-looking and self-absorbed, rather than having faith and hope that leads us to ask questions like, what can I contribute and what difference can I make? It's about living differently in varying respects, including how we regard death. And I thought that it echoed last week's message to those in faith, to persevere and keep going in the new life of Jesus, in this life. We can't know the detail of what life after death will be like. We do have the promise that God will not abandon those who believe that Jesus died and rose again, and that we shall share a new resurrection life. And that's what we put our hope in. Let us pray. Loving Father, we know that all human life is valuable to you, and that the good that is in each life will live on, with sins forgiven for those who have faith in Jesus. So may we have peace and hope in our own mortality, and know the strength of your promise to be close to us in your love, now and at the hour of our death, in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who died that all may live. Amen.
He makes me lie in pastures green.
will trust in you alone, and I will trust in you. Will lead me home. He guides my ways in righteousness, and He anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on His pure delights, and I will trust in you alone, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. And though I walk the darkest path, I will not fear the evil one, for you are with me, and your rod and staff are the comfort I need to know. And I will trust in you. In you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home.
Lord God, we stand before you in awe. You are always with us, and you show great mercy and patience. You alone offer eternal life. We bow before you, our forever King.
Lord Jesus, as we gather at the foot of your cross, we humbly bring our sins before you, acknowledging our need for mercy and guidance. Recent demonstrations have highlighted many shortcomings in our society's tolerance of racism. We are part of that society, and our silence or ignorance does not absolve us of our responsibility to love as you have taught us. We are sorry for our tolerance and our intolerance. We are sorry for the violence that has been present on both sides, for lives needlessly lost. Please forgive us. You have promised to protect us, yet so often we take our safety and well-being into our own hands, as if we could do better. As we continue to live under the shadow of a pandemic, yet with increasing calls to ease the lockdown, we have been quick to cast judgment and slow to listen. We are sorry for thinking of ourselves before others. Please forgive us. We have harboured resentment. We have let envy grow in our hearts. We have focused on earthly things at the expense of your kingdom. Please forgive us. Wash us clean. Restore us through your love and mercy. Set us back on the right path. Thank you for forgiving us. Amen.
Dear God, thank you for being ever present and active in our lives.
For Zoom in technology.
For some children being able to return to school.
For all the key workers.
For teaching us to appreciate the little things.
Lockdown starting to ease.
For all the volunteers.
For friends and family. Amen.
Lord, we bring before you our worries and fears. We pray for wisdom for our government and their scientific advisers. We pray for your guidance in how we continue to do church. Strengthen our faith so that we draw ever closer to you. We pray for safety as lockdown continues to ease and that people will resist the temptation to push the rules too far. We continue to pray for shop owners and other businesses as they work to reopen safely, and also for those who work in schools with ever-increasing numbers of children attending. Help the children as they adjust to another new normal within school. We also pray for those children who are not yet able to return to school and feel they are missing out. We bring before you in our hearts those we know who are suffering at this time, and for those who are grieving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Still my soul.
disappointment, grief and fear are gone. Sorrow forgotten, that's pure joy restored. Be still my soul, when change and tears are past. All safe and blessed we shall meet at last.
The blessing song has been circulating on social media recently, spreading the message of God's favour. It's gone beyond our church communities and has been reaching people that may have never heard this message before. Matthew Dawkins recently drew together Christians from our town to record the Shepton blessing, and we're going to use this now to send us off. As I said at the start of the service, if you'd like to use this time to leave a comment on how God has been blessing you, we would love to celebrate together as a church family. But before that, Sam's going to read the verses from Numbers where this blessing is taken from.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace.
May God bless us this week. Amen.
Upon you and a thousand generations your family and their children and their children and their children. May his favour be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favour be upon you.